Death in the pandemic. Death is a taboo subject, and perhaps many of the regulations and laws around this pandemic are influenced by our attitudes towards death. How is this pandemic affecting our attitudes towards death? Are we facing up to the inevitability of life? And do you like this hat?
Social distancing rules mean hardly anyone can attend a funeral now. Maybe 10 people at most, all 2 meters apart. Cremations are closed to the public. Only a small number of mourners are allowed at graveside burials. Some funerals are now being streamed online.
I've been to 2 funerals in the pandemic, one for my mate Jeff's dad and one for my uncle Jimmy. Funerals are weird. Have you been to one in the pandemic? In America, I know they're doing like sort of drive-throughs and there's a lot of online funerals, but I feel the function of a funeral is a kind of ceremonial theatre for us to acknowledge and register grief, of course, to show love and respect and to demonstrate support to those that are left behind. Stripped of this ability, where do we place death in our story of ourselves?
When you scroll down the Mission Funeral Home's Facebook page, you may see something you have never seen before. A funeral on Facebook Live.
On my podcast, Under the Skin, Charles Eisenstein talked about death and death becoming a taboo subject and how our attitudes towards death were being highlighted by the current pandemic. Ours is a society of death denial, from its hiding away of corpses to its fetish for youthfulness, to its warehousing of old people in nursing homes. Against the backdrop of the program of control, death denial and separate self, the assumption that public policy should seek to minimize the number of deaths is nearly beyond question, a goal to which other values like play, freedom, etc. are subordinate. COVID-19 offers occasion to broaden that view. Yes, let's hold life sacred, more sacred than ever. Death teaches us that. Let us hold each person, young or old, sick or well, as the sacred, precious, beloved being that they are. And in the circle of our hearts, let's make room for other sacred values too. To hold life sacred is not just to live long, it is to live well and right and fully. It's interesting to hear someone talk about our attitudes towards death, our inability to accept death, and how deeply embedded they are in our systemic ideologies. These ideals are so entrenched that it's impossible for us to see what our values are and how they affect the way we approach something like this year's events.
Now, the latest CDC report shows higher numbers of people are in mental health crisis and thinking about suicide alongside the pandemic.
London Ambulance shared information that crews are now attending an average of 37 suicides or attempted suicides per day, compared to 22 per day in 2019. Suicide is obviously a very difficult and challenging subject, particularly in a culture like ours that seems to have more and more taboos around death and a deepening inability to discuss it as a topic.
Traditional viewings and funeral gatherings of more than 10 people aren't allowed. So the Cantalmi Long Funeral Home in Bethlehem is adapting its usual services for these unusual times.
So we're doing a drive-through viewing.
It's interesting, isn't it? Our culture has to reach for the formats and templates that are available. Can't go to a normal funeral? Try a drive-through funeral. Can't go to a funeral? Try a Facebook Live funeral. But I wonder if these changes are detaching us from our core humanity. Our reverence for death and our rituals around death are one of the means that we use to diagnose whether or not we even have a civil society. We identify Bronze Age, Dark Age tribes, but oh look, they buried their dead, they're civilized people. What will future archaeologists think when they glance back to the dystopia we are currently being encouraged to inhabit?
So without ever leaving their cars, mourners paid their respects from a respectful 6-foot distance.
David Kessler, the grief expert, speaking on my podcast Under the Skin, said, in the past, hearses were constantly seen driving around a city. You've not been behind a hearse in a long time because now hearses only take a body, he's talking about in the United States, from the chapel to the graveside. The dead move around our cities in white unmarked vans. We've sanitized the experience of death. You want to see death? You've got to watch a movie or a series about it. There was a time when death was in your house. You watched your loved ones die up close, the same way you had weddings and you had deaths. We don't see death anymore. We forget things like the coffee table in the living room was literally there so we could put the death casket on it. That's what it was built for. If you look at old houses in the 40s, they have wide doors so that the casket could be moved in and out. I suppose what's happening And I believe this is as a result of prevailing cultural ideologies, is that we have, as David Kessler says, sanitized the experience of death, taken death out from the center of our life so that we can have this illusion of ongoing life. And the people that live at the very pinnacle of human culture, what's their attitude towards death? How are they living life? How are they tackling this immutable problem? As Kessler said, the death rate for human beings is 100%. We're still surprised by death, but it's going to happen to all of us. Or is it?
The ultra wealthy in Silicon Valley are investing money into companies trying to answer exactly those questions.
A number of billionaires have pumped money into research that aims to keep people fighting fit as they age. Google founders Sergey Brin and Larry Page have pumped millions into Calico, a secretive health venture which aims to solve death.
There's also BioAge, BioViva, the Longevity Fund, AgeX, the Methuselah Foundation, and many others.
Methuselah, the oldest person out of the Bible, living for 969 years. It's interesting to cite the Bible because really what I imagine is meant by people living a long time in a biblical and spiritual context is the idea of embracing a permanent, constant, transcendent aspect of human nature. The idea of even legacy, of becoming so identified with your values that the death of the body is insignificant. Not keep the body alive forever in a jar while the world burns.
Richest man in the world, Jeff Bezos, and billionaire PayPal co-founder Peter Thiel have both invested in the space.
It's interesting, isn't it, to see how stratification is becoming so extreme that there are now members of our society that can remove themselves from the ultimate unavoidable factor in all our lives, death itself. I find it curious that in this pandemic, funerals, a ceremony as old as our species, or at least as old as the civilizing impulse within our species, are being negated, marginalized, made technological, or forgotten altogether. Meanwhile, I suspect suicide is on the rise, people bringing about death as a solution to their own problem of simply being alive. And elsewhere, billionaires and a coterie of privileged folk are creating solutions to that problem. I suppose I'm collating these ideas to show how our attitudes are changing and how our experience of reality is changing and how we're becoming further and further removed from the type of lives we are evolved to have. Further from the beings that we have long been.
Right now in San Francisco, for $8,000, you can get a liter of blood from 16 to 25-year-olds injected into your body.
I mean, that's just a literal bit of vampirism there. Like, when you get to the point where you're buying up child blood, don't you think, yeah, I might want to try some meditation and having a little look in the mirror. I can't look in that mirror. Give me another glass of child blood. I'm a good guy.
Bulletproof founder Dave Asprey has spent more than $1 million hacking his own biology.
I, right now, am expecting to live to about 180. I think that's very achievable, assuming a truck doesn't hit me.
To make sense of this, you have to take it out of the broader context. The context is a world where some people are suffering such extraordinary lives. Even what we would class as ordinary existence has become such a macabre parody of drive-through funerals, suicide likely rising, that it seems odd that in that same physical space, peculiar and luxurious ideas like this are being seriously explored.
Whenever you meet a fundamental human need, there's a market. And in this case, the market for age-related disease and aging is a $1 trillion market.
Everything a market now, huh? Everything a market. The defiance of death a market. Challenging though, because thinking for myself, oh, there's some treatment I could get that would mean I'd be able to spend more time with my children. Any one of us will take it. I suppose that's the risk. Unless we develop a value system based on timeless, perennial principles, integrity, honor, love, kindness, then it's unbearable to live in the material world. Death is unbearable. The loss of loved ones becomes unbearable. Decay, aging, all these things become unbearable unless we prioritize different values. This, I think, is what we are experiencing now. We've lost our connection to the unknowable, to the mystery, to the beauty of life, that which can never be understood rationally and logically. We've pushed it out into the margins. We've prioritized materialism and rationalism to a degree where we have no connection to beauty, to things that are very, very hard to know, but very easy to feel. This is what funerals do, is they connect us in a way that's difficult to quantify or make sense of, but we recognize that life is a shared experience, death is a shared experience, that even though we've lost someone, we continue and they live on in our memories, they live on in our love. The reason you get people ending their own life, alienation, despair. The reason you get billionaires prolonging their life, no acknowledgement of the sacred. It's the same problem throughout this system. Not only do we need to find ways of reviving the ceremonies around death, we need to experience them again in a renewed way, revivify them, awaken to them, awaken to a life worthy of death, live a life with real meaning, celebrate values that are not just about acquisition and personal excellence, but about shared excellence, shared growth, togetherness.
From selling dietary supplements to stem cell injections, there is already a huge amount of money being made.
These are all things that I like, I'm attracted to, but what I think when I see that is, oh my God, I want that stuff. But then I think, hold on, accept reality, accept death, accept the sadness of losing people that you love. And I suppose by connecting to that love, experiencing that love, you can transcend the fear of knowing, oh, I'm getting older, I'm not going to be young forever, I'm not young anymore, everyone I love is going to die. If we don't make a place at the table for reality, for death, for the sacredness in impermanence, then we are doomed to create, even in areas of scientific endeavor, a kind of shadow world, an ugly dystopia.
The biggest concern for many is that anti-aging interventions are being developed as a tool for the wealthy. Investment in such research by the ultra-rich can be seen as trying to buy the one thing money hasn't yet been able to buy them, immortality.
None of us want to die, or, you know, those of us that do are presumed to be unwell, but all of us must learn to accept death, accept our own death and the death of one another. Perhaps whether you believe in God or you don't, this can certainly create an environment where we celebrate and love life while we're here, while we revere and honor one another, where we revere life itself, rather than continually refining our focus to personal advancement.
This utopian dream of living forever, and I do believe that the anti-aging proponents are not just interested in adding another 10 or 20 years to their lifespan. They're really looking for immortality, but it is a narcissistic dream because I have yet to hear a single social good that will bring.
If you've lost someone during the pandemic, either because they've taken their own life or because they've died of coronavirus or related causes or anything, the solution perhaps is to journey within yourself, to look at your own values, to connect with people in a different way, to enjoy life differently when enjoying life becomes plausible and possible. And even now, I was told by a wise elder, focus on the things that you can do, not the things you can't do. Certainly, my feelings are that if we create a fairer society that isn't entirely organized around the further augmentation of the privilege of a few, that more of us will be able to enjoy life and accept death, accept the inevitability of death, and accept the beauty and pain of life. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please like, subscribe, share, and if you want more raw, unedited information from me, please go to russellbrand.com and sign up to become a member of our online community. Then there'll be nothing between us. Thank you.